Workers at the earthquake-flattened school in Mexico City continue to dig out a 12-year-old girl trapped in the rubble. As correspondent Rosa Flores reports, they periodically lift their arms to signal onlookers.
They're asking for silence. That means hope for those parents that have this agonizing wait, who are waiting to hear if their children are safe.
The Dow is down 35 points, the Nasdaq down 17. I'm Jim Ascendio.
This is Charles Osgood. For many businesses, hiring is tough. That makes it critical to choose the right place to post your jobs. You need qualified candidates fast and on budget. And you don't want to sign a long-term contract or pay upfront fees. That's why you need Indeed.com, the world's number one job site. Independent research shows Indeed delivers 6 times more hires than any other job site. You can post a job in minutes and even set up screener questions to help you zero in on qualified candidates. You can review applicants, take notes, and schedule interviews, all from an online dashboard that's easy to use. For a limited time, Indeed is offering new users a $50 credit to make their first job listing a sponsored job with premium visibility so more candidates will see it. Find out why over 3 million businesses use Indeed for hiring. To redeem this offer, go to Indeed.com/credit. That's Indeed.com/credit. Terms, conditions, and quality standards apply.
After lead levels increased in Flint, Michigan, there were fewer pregnancies and more fetal deaths.
Birth rates went down by about 12%, and fetal death rates went up by 58%.
University of Kansas Assistant Professor David Slusky is one of the co-authors who analyzed data from before and after Flint's water crisis.
Represents a couple hundred fewer children born.
There was a switch from water supplied by the city of Detroit in April 2014 to using the Flint River as a drinking water source without adding needed treatment, causing lead levels in drinking water to spike.
Medical literature that lead interferes with pregnancy.
Flint has since gone back to its original water source, but residents didn't know about problems for over a year. I'm Joe Ramsey.
Confused by those sell-by, use-by, or display-until food labels? Well, 400 of the largest consumer goods companies across 70 countries will simplify the labels, hoping to end that confusion. I'm Jim Ascendio.
Choosing the right makeup is critical to that first impression and keeping your skin looking young and healthy. That's why Santa Clarita's Jen Gerard created Gerard Cosmetics. Inspired by women of all ages who gravitate toward classic and timeless beauty with a modern twist, Gerard Cosmetics. Superb quality and pigmentation, along with lip glosses and lipsticks in colors for everyone. The internationally acclaimed Gerard Cosmetics. Discover your new look at GerardCosmetics.com.
The best live theater can be found right here in the Santa Clarita Valley. The Canyon Theater Guild has been entertaining audiences for decades with top-quality musicals and plays. Located in Old Town Newhall, the CTG also offers workshops for the young actor in your family. For more information, call the box office at 799-2702 or go to canyontheater.org.
Drugs or alcohol abuse can tear a family apart. In Santa Clarita, just like everywhere else, it's an epidemic. The Way Out Recovery is here to help. Call them now at 296-4444 or visit them on the web at thewayoutrecoverysCV.com. The Way Out offers outpatient treatment for adolescents, adults, and family members. The Way Out is compassionate, caring, professional, and confidential. You and your family don't have to suffer any longer. Call The Way Out Recovery now, 296-4444, or visit thewayoutrecoverysCV.com and make an appointment. Asking for help is the first step.
It's summertime party time. Have an office, birthday, bridal, or any party coming up? Flame and Skewers offers an excellent selection of tasty cuisine at reasonable prices. You gotta try it. We have healthy, fresh catering options for all your upcoming events. Visit our newest location in Granary Square, Valencia on McBean Parkway. Order online at flameandskewers.com or come in. Flame and Skewers, healthy, fresh Mediterranean food at its best.
Hey there, it's Story with your hometown station weather. Possible early afternoon showers with a high of 71 degrees. Overnight lows in the low 50s. Tomorrow, sunny skies, a high of 74. More of the same on Saturday. The River Rally, River Cleanup, and Environmental Expo is Saturday, this Saturday, September 23rd, from 8 to 11 a.m. behind the shopping center on Soledad Canyon in Santa Clarita. For more information, go to hometownstation.com.
Good afternoon, Santa Clarita. You're listening to Our Way on the Highway, a radio show hosted by local students from SCVI Charter School. And today we have a special guest in studio joining us. Her name is Amber Raskin. Amber, thanks for taking the time to be here today.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. In case you don't know who Amber is, let me give you just kind of a brief introduction. Amber Raskin was a Hollywood television producer, and I call her a conscious mom, who left the industry to raise her kids, and somehow she ended up changing the educational system, especially starting with our community here in Santa Clarita. And there's this famous quote that is flying around the school from a previous student and an alumni there at SCVI, and she says, "I hope you understand how many lives you've changed and how many people you've inspired through SCVI and iLead Schools. Through these charter schools and learning studios, you've created a world where anyone can create and everyone has a chance to succeed." Wow, what a legacy and what a journey you've been on in transforming the school system. Do you realize what kind of a difference you're making in your community?
Well, definitely brings me to tears to hear that and know how Sydney says we've impacted her. And I ongoingly visit and am moved to tears and thrilled that we can have that kind of impact. It was what I wanted for myself. It was what I needed when I was that age, and I'm so pleased that we can provide it for students today.
So was it just part of your vision that you decided that there needed to be change, or you saw something either from your experience growing up in mm-hmm. the educational system that you wanted more for your kids or something mm-hmm. different for your kids? I don't like to look at good, bad, right, or wrong or put judgment right. in there, but just something different that the newer school kids are yearning for, a different way to learn.
Yeah, I absolutely want to say that we started this first school in the network of iLead Schools in the midst of a lot of really amazing district schools. So in no way am I saying that districts are doing anything wrong. They're really fantastic. These are the best of the best districts, and they're serving a lot of kids. But in the spirit of charter schools, I think choice is really important, and not every style works for every student or person. And it didn't work for me when I was 30 years ago when I was in high school. And I really felt like I had to recover from my education because there was something about it that didn't allow me to thrive or have choice or connect or realize what my potential was. And thank goodness I was able to do that after I got out of high school and thought, wow, if we could just have a few more choices, a few more approaches for kids who have different learning styles, that would hopefully serve a lot. And I thought it would serve my own kids, my son and my daughter, because I looked at my daughter, who was the older one, and thought she really needs something different like I did, and so set out to create that. And it's mostly about giving them, taking away some of the conventional thoughts of how school used to be, and showing them that we can create it anew, in the way that entrepreneurs do, because I had a lot of entrepreneurs in my family, and I wanted my kids to be entrepreneurs, and I knew if we could, or I hoped if we could change the format a little bit, that it might allow them to look at systems and life and business and career and themselves differently. And I know for my daughter it's working, because she's doing great in college now.
Yes, she is.
Yeah.
She's thriving. She's yeah. You know, thinking outside the box, she believes in herself. She mm-hmm. has the confidence because you surrounded her around a village of people that asked her the right questions yeah. for her to self-reflect and find all those answers within herself. You know, it was more of a space of facilitators mm-hmm. that developed growth and helped the kids decide their own answers. And that's yes. what I love about the school, is because it creates free thinkers, and mm-hmm. it creates real true leadership mm-hmm. where I don't think that some of the traditional schools are focused on that. And if they are, They're kind of slowly transitioning, and probably because of the model that, or some of the models mm-hmm. that traditionally in charter schools are doing today, right?
Yeah, I'm proud to be part of the movement because, like, High Tech High, which is a famous charter school that does project-based learning, they really started bringing project-based learning to the consciousness of the larger education system.
Right.
And so a lot of schools are now getting into that. And another thing that we also added when we did our own flavor of project-based learning was social-emotional learning. And that's really what allows them to feel safe enough to fail. Because we feel like if you can't fail, it doesn't count. So it has to be real and meaningful. And they have to, kids have to once in a while not do well and then learn how to adjust and pick themselves up and start over again from that. And I do feel like that's what helped my daughter and other kids who started two businesses in high school. During high school, she started two businesses. One of them was for her economics class. She started a theater company, and it's still running today. They've had three productions. And on top of that, it was all student-run or young adult-run, and they figured out how to make it all happen on their own. And they really could fail and did a couple of times. In fact, one of the productions lost money, and then they had to look at how from that do they adjust, and then they figured out a creative solution to do something, cut some costs in the next production, and they're learning how to make it sustainable now. And she also had the courage to move to New York, I think, because she felt that she had practiced so many of the skills that you need to move so far away from home. I'm not doing as well as she is.
Well, it would only make sense that if you help somebody discover they have wings, at a certain point they're going to say, it's time for me to fly. And
yeah.
It just comes with developing leaders, is that they now have the confidence to go out and take on the world, to navigate the challenges that the world's going to throw at them. And that's what you guys are producing there from that school.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm really excited about it, because in my early 20s, when I had my first conscious awakening and I realized that I wanted to help other people awaken from this social slumber of following everyone's lead rather than discovering my own leader within me, my vision was to be in the forefront of education and causing that conscious shift. So when I met you, I was excited and
yeah.
giddy, and I was like, both of our journeys are aligned, and that's why I've always been a supporter of SCVI Charter and the iLead school system. And I'm one of your biggest champions and mm-hmm. one of your biggest cheerleaders, and I want you to win big time.
Mm-hmm.
But now you caused this little firestorm here in Santa Clarita, and now it just, like, embers started flying off into other parts of the country,
mm-hmm.
and it's going on to bigger and better things, right?
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, there's our mission, Don's and my, the other founder and CEO, and my mission is really to just help other communities and other people realize what education can be, and bring this mission and this style of education to as many communities as want us. And so there was an authorizer in Ohio who came to visit us, and he asked us to bring our model there. About 4 years ago now, he visited our schools here, and he said, will you please, please, please bring this to Ohio? So with an invitation, we said, okay, because it's really hard to replicate out of state. And it's now growing. We're working on a second school in Ohio and another one in Indiana that we have a partnership with. And we had the same thing from community members in Hawaii. We have some people in Hawaii who really wanted to be part of us. And so we're continuing to have people come, see what we've done here. And, because we've not only have SCVI, but we've created a cluster of schools in California. So we have about 10 locations in California, and then we're working on doing more clusters like that in other areas so that they can share resources and grow together, because there's a huge benefit in collaboration. So Ohio, I just got back last night actually from the Midwest, looking at the Midwest region that's growing out there, and it was it's pretty exciting.
That's awesome. It's kind of the philosophy that I believe in, which is discover your own light and then shine your light so bright that other people see and recognize the light and ask themselves, do we not have a light like that of my own? Or, hey, I want that. And that's what you guys did. You shined your light and other people recognize its value and decided that, hey, I want that too for my community. And that's pretty amazing to be asked to come out and create that and other parts of the country, and hopefully different parts of the world as well.
Yeah, that's the plan. We hope to eventually go worldwide, and we have partnerships internationally that we're continuing to work on and continuing to refine what replication looks like, because that's not so easy. We're very relationship-based. We're very working with people one-on-one is very, very important to us, so it gets a little harder when you have to get on a plane to do
that. That's awesome. And one of the programs you created in this forum, or in the framework of creating opportunities for kids to discover their own gifts and their own talents and really developing leaders, is a program that you partnered here with KTS to create a radio show where kids get a chance to find their own voice and find interesting subjects to talk about. And we've already, is it been a year now that we've had this program on
yes,
and running?
Yes, we're starting our second year now, which is very exciting.
Isn't
and,
it?
And along the lines of what I was saying before, relationships are key and partnerships are key. And we're so grateful for KHTS and what they've done to mentor us in so many ways over the years in how to serve the Santa Clarita community and how to run a business and how to build relationships. They've been amazing.
Yeah,
and
big shout out to Carl and Jerry for opening that space to allow, you know, some kids in a community come in and just, you know, introduce them to a possible career in broadcasting or anything that, you know, lights their fire and has them go off in a direction where they chase their passion.
And they also take interns from our schools, and they've hired several interns from
our schools. That's right.
And they've just been incredible. They're just, Carl and Jerry are such an incredible contribution to Santa Clarita. They are such a jewel of what we have here.
Absolutely.
So grateful in so many ways
for
them.
Sure. So in case you're just joining us, you're listening to Our Way and the Highway, which is a radio show hosted by local students from SCVI Charter. And we actually have a couple students joining us in the studio that are going to be a part of this new program. And this is your first day in the studio, on the air. And I'd like to introduce these new learners. We have Josh and Bella. Josh and Bella, thanks for joining us on the show today. Are you guys nervous?
Sort of.
That's okay. It's part of the process, right? Being nervous and going forward anyways. So let me introduce Josh and Bella. Josh, I guess you're into movies and playing video games, which is probably what most guys, young guys do, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, normally with like movies and television, there's, you know, like specific things that people like, action and stuff with that. I'm more into the nerdy things.
Okay, so. All right. So you're embracing your inner nerd. I love that.
Yeah.
And you could probably only do that in a school that says, you know, embrace who you are and what you're about. Don't try to form yourself to be like everyone else, but embrace who you are and what you're about, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
And so it also says that you love writing scripts and you're interested in acting and movies. Do you want to be an actor?
I actually am an actor.
Are you?
Yeah.
Have you done some projects?
I have done a movie called The Green Hornet, where I played young Seth Rogen.
Okay.
I did a movie called The Incredible Burt Wonderstone with Steve Carell, Steve Buscemi, Jim Carrey, all of them.
Okay.
And a couple of other things.
You got
too.
That Rogen kind of esque.
Yeah.
I can see that.
I've been told.
That's pretty awesome. And so you're also developing your own podcast on the YouTube channel.
Yeah, it's called The JL Nerd Herd, and I do it with my two best friends, and we just basically talk about all nerdy things and our opinions on things, reviews, and it's been a lot of fun, and it's been really opening me out lately. So
Amber, it sounds like you're attracting all the creative people in life that are got this little seed inside of them that says, I got a gift, or I that life has to be more than just learning, but also being creative and letting my light shine, almost like a Fame.
Yes.
Right? A program, like a theater of arts kind of a program, too.
Yeah, we attract all the creatives and all the entrepreneurs.
Yeah,
That's who finds us.
That's where I want my grandkids to go.
Yeah, absolutely. Me too.
Yeah, we're going to sign them up because I want them to realize that their creativeness is going to be their magic wand or paintbrush to paint a canvas full of life and possibilities for themselves.
Well, there's an interesting thing about that dynamic, too, that I just want to briefly say, which is that, you know, in the last century, the things were rote, and that was how you won. You did the things that lawyers learn and memorize to do that. And what the shift that seems to be happening in society now is the creatives are taking over. So now a lot of things that people used to learn to memorize and do that were kind of automated, but by humans, are now automated by machines. So being able to be creative and put context around and think about around those things and think about how to put those to good use in society, that is really the new success story. So it's becoming more and more important to be those creative people, even if you're not in a creative industry, to take creativity to the problem solving that you do in any industry.
Absolutely. In case you didn't know this, I'm one of your biggest sales recruiters, because people come to me and go, hey, tell me about this SVI school. And what I tell them is, you know, back when my dad was going to school, back then you didn't have technology at your fingertips. So for you to study and learn and memorize and take tests and have a lot of information to regurgitate or even to get your college degree, back then it symbolized that you had a certain work ethic that made you credible. I said, in today's world, information you don't need to memorize because it's literally at your fingertips. Mm-hmm. Today it's about being creative and it's about being emotionally powerful and you have to really have an inner confidence about you to go out in the world and take on these challenges that you let the world know, okay, here I am.
Yes.
And so that's what I tell parents. If you want your kids to develop that part of them so that they can take on the challenges that today the world is throwing at them, this is the school to be at because it creates that environment for them to develop and foster that kind of those inner qualities.
Yeah, I absolutely. We say it all the time. That's why we added social-emotional learning to our very prevalent part of what we do.
And people are still learning what social and emotional learning is. And that's why shows like this and talking about it more is educating people, because 20 or 25 years ago, if I would have listened to this show, I would have been like, what does that mean? I probably could have listened to 10 shows and still not understand what you're talking about.
Well, and there's some things like that. You know, education is shifting. The pendulum is swinging to a different focus. And I think a lot of educators know that, but the parents don't and the public doesn't. So we're talking about it over and over is really important.
Yeah, absolutely. And now we have Bella in studio. How are you, Bella?
I'm good. How are you?
Every time I hear your name, I think of Che bella, right? It was that Italian for what? How beautiful.
How beautiful, yeah.
Nice. Awesome. I love that. So you're into theater. Yeah. Are you an actress as well?
Yeah, I am.
Okay. So how long have you been doing theater?
I've been doing theater since I was in fifth grade. My first production was with the school.
Okay. I heard you're in a play too from SCVI.
Yeah, I'm in the Midsummer Night's Dream play.
Okay. And are you excited about that?
Yeah.
What role do you have?
I play Helena.
And do you have to study that role, like, to become that character?
Yeah, it's a really outgoing role. So.
And so does she have a certain voice, your character? Or?
No, she's just very loud.
Very loud.
Yeah.
Okay, can you bring us a little bit of that loudness, or you gotta channel that person, right?
Well, she's very in love with Demetrius, so she's kind of outgoing in that way.
And so, what do you love most about doing theater? Is that like your passion? Does it make you feel alive, or what is it about theater?
It's just
that
a way
really
to get my mind off of like things that are going on outside of theater. So it's really fun for me.
So it's a place that you can focus outward and get yourself into something that kind of takes you away from whatever it is that you don't want to deal with, or what?
It's kind of like when you don't like you want to get away from your like life sometimes when you're kind of sad.
Just a little time out. Let me get a little time out and do some fun stuff.
Assume somebody else's character
there you go.
for a little while. Yeah.
Yeah, just to kind of get away or take you into a different type of world where you can just express yourself and be playful too. Isn't the arts about being playful as well?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
I mean, you're not being yourself when you're doing these things. And like even with writing, it's your way of using your imagination and creating a whole world of just you being playful.
Now, Bella, what's the difference between doing Shakespeare and other kinds of shows?
Well, you really have to have the word by word in order for it to make sense. And I think that it's also harder to memorize lines because it's not usually how you talk now. So it's kind of like that.
Can I ask
a quick question too?
Yeah.
Bella, how long have you been at SCVI?
I've been at SCVI since I was in first grade.
And how has that helped you prepare for theater and what you're doing now?
It's helped me become more comfortable with speaking in public.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I've become more of a problem solver.
Yeah. That's great.
Well, listen, we got to take a break. Stay tuned for more of Our Way on the Highway right here in your hometown station, KHTS.
Hi, I'm Miles McNamara, certified senior.
And welcome back to Our Way on the Highway. This is a radio show hosted by students from SEVI Charter School here in Santa Clarita. And in case you guys don't know, this is the second series or season of the show. And we're actually kind of profiling some of the new hosts, some of the new students that are going to be hosting the show for the very first time. So this is kind of an introduction to you guys and kind of getting the nerves out and just, you know, giving you a little flavor and a little taste of what it's like to be on the radio. Because from here on moving forward, you guys are going to pretty much transition into taking over the show and hosting it yourself and doing all the conversations. But I think, you know, the gist of this show is to introduce to people that can follow along or listen or watch and watch you guys grow through the process. I think that's the most exciting part, really, is to watch them week to week and month to month to kind of just become comfortable and in their skin and finding their own voice and sharing and connecting with each other on live on the radio.
Yeah, so the concept for this show was Jerry, station owner, was talking to us for several years before we started about having kids produce a show. And so we did last season, and now we're starting the second season, as you said. And one thing I want to make clear is it's a class at the school. So you guys signed up for the class, you for a second year in a row, right?
Yeah, my second year.
And so the idea is that they're eventually going to produce it all and be the hosts and get all the guests and do all of that. So we're taking steps towards that. And today we're here to introduce the four people who are here to be on air for the first time. Yeah. Well, Nathan's not the first time.
Yeah, joining us in studio, we have Nathan and Caitlin. So welcome to the show.
Thank you.
And well, the cool thing about this, as I'm watching, is if you're on Facebook Live, you can actually watch us in the studio and see their faces and our faces, and you can actually see how we do a radio show. But just watch the, you know, how you're, you know, showing some of your. Are you nervous?
I mean, I never done a radio show before, so it's new.
Yeah, and so, you know, it's just part of the progress, part of learning, a part of growing. And
what are some of the things you guys did to prepare for today?
Well, we didn't do much preparing. We have been practicing interviewing in class, however, between each other. We've actually done a little thing where we turned a bunch of desks to represent this desk right here. I know some people can't exactly see it, but like if you're on the camera, like he said, Facebook Live, you can see it. And we have prepared to get a little visualization of what everything's going to look like. So we prepared a little bit, but not like 100%.
Well, because class hasn't been going on for that long, so yeah, you probably haven't had much time, right?
Yeah, we've only had a few classes.
It only meets a couple times a week because it's an elective, and you school's only been in session for about a month, right?
So how about role playing? Do you guys role play?
Yeah, we have been doing that when interviewing lately.
We just try to like replicate, you know, what the scenario is.
Yeah.
What about like picking a topic and then just going back and forth and having conversations about that topic? Do you do
we
that?
Actually have made paragraphs, like short paragraphs, about our lifestyle and our interests and all that stuff, and we have built upon that. Thanks to Cindy's help, we've managed to edit it to feature some stuff about our class, about our self-interests, what we like to do, which is on the paper right here, as you two can see. And we've been doing a little role play, and Cindy was pretending to be either Alex or Amber, and we would be the hosts, and she would interview us questions about our paragraphs, about ourselves, and we would basically just talk about our self-interests and why we like them, what we like, and all that stuff.
So, Caitlin, let me ask you this question. Does it, in the role-playing, does it feel the same way that it does knowing that you're live on the radio, or is it...
I feel like... when you're live, I feel like it gives like a different like vibe, in a sense that it's like the real thing versus, you know, just like role play. So yeah.
And what if you can trick your mind into believing that it's just role playing even when you're live? Would that benefit you? Would that help you develop a certain skill set?
Yeah, I feel like any skill, just pretending it's not the real thing, would help someone, you know, get over nerves. Or
yeah, like if you're going into an interview for a job and you're really in the interview and you trick your mind into believing you're just role-playing with your sister or you're role-playing with your mom, it kind of, it relaxes you, right? It lets you just kind of get centered and grounded and just share authentically.
You were going to say?
I was just going to ask another question. Did you have you had time to reflect on any of last year's shows? Have you been able to analyze anything about what worked and didn't work about last year to improve on it?
Well, last year, towards the end of the year, we kind of worked upon how we were on the radio shows. Sometimes after we did the shows, we got to watch the video on YouTube in front of the class and stuff. We didn't do it a lot. We only did, I think, maybe once or twice. I'm not sure. Last year, though, we did do a little session where we did a mock interview in front of the class, and we took a recorder and recorded it. One kid had a laptop, so we were able to actually take the sound and listen to it over a while. It didn't work too well because there were some issues. But this year, I'm hoping some stuff can turn out a little different to compare to last year, which obviously I'm the only person that actually came back to the class from last year. But I'm hoping this year will change a lot.
Well, I noticed that you already have learned because you were in here before the show started talking about how to be close to the mic and how to sit. And so that's pretty awesome.
Here's another observation I'm noticing about Nathan. If you're watching on Facebook Live, you can watch when he talks. He's swiveling around the microphone like a professional already. And that goes to show you that that was the coaching from last season.
Last year, yeah.
And he's implementing it like it's just like breathing, right? Once you learn it, you just kind of develop it and it just becomes part of what you're up to.
Really, yeah, it's just really easy.
It is natural now. Yeah. So what did you think you're going to get out of this class? Why did you take this class? What excited you about the possibility of broadcasting or doing this kind of program?
I never actually been interested in a field like that, so I thought it'd be pretty cool to try it out and, you know, explore new options. And so I just really wanted to figure out how radio hosting works and what's the setup and new things.
So it was just more of curiosity, but it sounded interesting enough to...
Yeah.
What do you think some of the challenges are? How does a class like this challenge your fears or maybe, you know, calls out... It maybe forces you to kind of look at some of your insecurities and have a breakthrough in them and kind of step out of your comfort zone.
Well, me personally, I never done interviewing. So in class, when we have to role play interviewing, it enables us to try to think outside the box and ask questions to get information out.
And that sounds like a creative tool, right? You have to really be creative to come up with new questions on the spot.
Mm-hmm.
How good are you creating questions for some of your guests?
Well, last year I was able to do a few questions. I mostly relied on the other kids when they were not busy. But this year I wouldn't say I'm the best at it. I can do a few questions. I lost a little bit of the skill last year because of the summer has been a little bit busy with me with my family lately. But I would say I could do like at least 5 questions within a few minutes of some people if I really know
them. One of the things I notice about broadcasting or being on the radio or being a host is you really have to be present. Do you know what that means?
Like being on the spot. Like
you have to really be in this moment and listening to people. You have to have and develop these skills, like great listening skills. And you really have to be paying attention in a certain way that you're actually understanding what they're saying. Because if you start mind wandering while the person's talking and you're, you know, going like this and you check out, you're missing what the person's telling you. And what also you're missing is certain things that they're telling you to be able to ask them those questions. So you really have to be present and paying attention to your guests so that you can ask them the right questions.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's next for you? What do you want to create for this? Do you want to be in this seat? Do you want to be one of the hosts? Or do you like more of the behind-the-scenes kind of deal with the radio?
I'm still thinking about, like, what I want to get out of this class. I'm just sort of exploring, you know, all the options that's in the class.
Well, you have 30 days to figure it out. Do you know who's going to be the next person in the hot seat? Who are your two main people who are going to come up on the show next month?
We haven't really discussed that much. I would like to do it myself, though, because I've done it last year. Because last year, I originally wanted to do stuff behind the scenes, but I was, like, more so pushed into the hot seat position, which I'm actually starting to like being on the air compared to behind the scenes, which I'm already in the film class at my school, so I'm already doing stuff behind the scenes. Why not do stuff on front of the scene? So this year, I'm kind of expecting myself to do more of this than compared to last year, which last year I was a little bit nervous at first. I wasn't the best last year, but this year I'm hoping things will change. But I'm hoping I can be one of the people.
Well, I think that's the process of growth is, yeah. You know, last time I was nervous, but this time I'm not as nervous. And so it's just a matter of getting people in that process.
It speaks to putting yourself out of your comfort zone.
Yeah,
like, kudos to you.
It's about challenging yourself.
You put yourself out. You tried it. You were nervous. Then you reflected on it and then thought, I kind of like that. That's pretty awesome.
And you keep coming back, right? You signed up again for another round. That says a lot about you and wanting to continue to grow to the next level. And now you're going to be kind of one of the veteran show hosts, and then you'll now take someone else on, and you guys will both develop and grow, and you'll kind of lead by example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I look forward to hearing what the class discusses between now and the next episode about what your intentions are for the year, what you're planning for the year, what you want to create this year. That's exciting.
Are you guys excited to interview certain guests, you know, leaders of the community or interesting people in the community? Does that interest you too? Like, I wonder who we're going to get next. Like, I get to ask certain questions. Does that interest you to kind of interview people in the community that can bring some wisdom to you or insight or just to be interested in what they're up to?
Yeah, I think that'd be really cool to get to know others in the community that have input and to get information.
Okay. What about you?
Well, last year I really enjoyed interviewing people such as the mayor or I forget what was the other person's name. I think it was like something with I can't remember. But anyway, I do enjoy interviewing people to be able to get to know them and spread the information on the radio. So, like, for example, they don't have to look on the internet for research that could take them forever to find. Instead, they can just listen to the radio for people bringing out the information from them.
Awesome.
And also the surprise of finding out who to interview next.
All right. Sounds good. So my last question to both of you is what kind of grade do you think you're going to get in this class?
I would say most likely an A if I work hard.
And for you?
I think I'll get an A too.
And why? Tell me why. What great qualities do you have that you trust in yourself that will help you get that A?
Definitely effort, because I really try to put my all to anything I do.
I love that.
Same here, because last year I was really nervous at first. But this year I'm hoping to use my skills I achieved last year to really improve this year.
So it says a lot about your belief in yourself. You're optimistic and you trust in yourself. And you know that if you bring a bunch of effort that you'll get graded appropriately and get your A. And that you know that as long as you keep pushing forward, that you're just going to keep growing and evolving and you'll get your A.
Congrats on putting yourself out there and taking the risk, being here first, you know, the first episode.
Absolutely.
And then really putting the actions behind what your intentions are. Good for you.
Awesome. Stay tuned for more of Our Way on the Highway right here in your hometown station, KHTS.
Fruit arranged like flowers? What a delicious idea! Edible Arrangements specializes in creating a variety of fresh fruit arrangements overflowing with fresh, hand-designed fruit and filled with strawberries, pineapple, grapes, cantaloupe, honeydew, and seasonal favorites. Made to order in a size you select and ready to eat and enjoy. You can even add chocolate to any arrangement. Edible Arrangements is always fresh, always appropriate, and always appreciated. Order yours today, 253-0052 or ediblearrangements.com. Edible Arrangements is on Soledad near Bouquet Canyon.
You've seen them on Spike TV's Bar Rescue. Now experience the Cajun Belle in Canyon Country. The Cajun Belle, a terrific mix of SoCal Creole and the most flavorful handmade cocktails in our valley. It's the happening place, beginning with Blues Night every Wednesday from 7 to 11. Thursday is Karaoke Night with All Night Happy Hour featuring $1 tacos. Friday is Ladies Night with the coolest DJ in town. Check out live cover bands every weekend. The Cajun Belle on Soledad opposite the Canyon Country Post Office.
Life takes us in different directions, and we may not always have computer access for breaking news. KHTS has a solution. Text alerts. Breaking news you need to know about fast. Freeway closed? We'll text you directly. Emergency police activity in the Santa Clarita Valley? We'll text you. Sign up now for text alerts at hometownstation.com. KHTS has your back.
Hometown Station.
And welcome back to Our Way on the Highway, a radio show hosted by local students from SEVI Charter. And we have Josh and Bella back in the studio. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Back on the radio. So tell us a little bit about how excited you are. I'm assuming, and again, I'm making an assumption that you're excited to be on the radio and be in this class. Is that a pretty accurate assumption that you're excited?
I'm actually really excited because I want to work forward on my talking skills, and you know, what better place to do that than here on a microphone in front of, you know, people.
Yeah, and it also sharpens your skills for theater too and for acting.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Keeps you sharp and on your toes.
Tell us how your acting and your podcast prepared you for this and what the difference is.
Well, I think it prepared me for this because I'm very confident here. Like I'm not just sitting here like super like in my chair scared. So I feel like that's what that kind of has done for me. Just talking in front of a mic makes it kind of easier to talk in front of a mic.
Mm-hmm.
And it's different because I'm not used to like a desk. I'm just used to like a really low quality microphone and like three dudes sitting in front of a really low quality camera and then just immediately posting that right onto the internet. So it's a very big different change, but I'm so far enjoying that.
Raises the bar a little.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's exciting.
And so what are you excited about, Bella?
I'm really excited because I just feel like, it can help with my public speaking skills. And I'm not really good at speaking, like, I feel like improv is a good way to, like, compare this to. Like, I'm only really good at being, like, making jokes.
Scripted or, yeah, scripted, like, memorizing definitely. It and then giving your all into it.
Yeah, I like to be prepared a lot.
Okay, so. All right, yeah. So this is going to challenge you to really be in, like I was telling the other kids, to be really present and in the moment and then just mm-hmm. articulating your thoughts and kind of going with a flow of a conversation. And then also asking questions to some of the guests that you're going to have on the show. Are you guys excited about that, to see who you're going to sit down with from month to month and who you're going to interview?
Yeah, I'm very excited for that. I like meeting new people, so.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm excited because I just feel like it would be cool to learn more about our city and stuff like that. Yeah.
Let me ask you this question. What kind of interpersonal challenges do you think you have to face or overcome being on the radio and being a part of this class? What are some of the fears or some of the challenges that you're going to have to just have a breakthrough in? What would it be for each one of you?
Probably not stuttering sometimes because I like to explain everything also.
Okay.
When I get passionate for certain things, I start to talk really fast. So I don't want to be like on the radio, like you know, like good evening, how are you today? Like, oh my God, I just had like six cups of coffee. Oh my God. So
can I help you?
Yeah.
I've been doing radio for almost 4 or 5 years, and I still do that. I still have my wife tell me when I come home. She's like, Alex, slow down. And I
me too.
And I tell her,
my mom just texted me when I left.
It's like part of it's part of being passionate.
It's part. I tell her I'm so excited about what I talk about. That it's a mindful thing. It's a practice of being mindful, just saying, Alex, slow mm-hmm. it down, slow it down. But when I get excited about stuff, it just comes out. I'm like a little kid in the candy store, right? So we have to learn how to harness that excitement and then just kind of slow roll it down, kind of savoring the moment, and then just so we don't turn people off or kind of push them away.
And also, like, I sometimes like to get all of, like, my sentence out, like, everything out, all my thoughts, and I kind of say it in one breath, so my mom always tells me, like, did you even breathe in that sentence?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. And when you're in the world of having conversations or opening up possibilities for people to see, you start to realize that you can't give people too much info because they can't handle it. You got to give them in bite-sized chunks, almost like in segments,
mm-hmm.
Just like we're doing on the radio. There's three segments, so let's not try to get the whole show in the first 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. Let's set it up in certain – and you'll learn all that, and I'm sure you're learning it in theater too. It's like we can't come out and do it all. We got to do it in segments. We got to prep them. There's certain stages. Does that not make sense for you guys?
Oh, that
there's stages to kind of prep that.
There's all kinds of things to work on. I think about coming back from the Midwest, you know, they say that we don't think we have an accent, but what I sound like is a Californian because I say like and awesome and
That's
all
right.
of those things. And some of those pieces, too, are another place to level up for me, too, because it's when you're speaking, and especially when people are just hearing it, not watching it on Facebook Live, there's all those little pieces make a difference. So it'll be fun to see you over the year evolve.
What about the ums? Do any of you guys have the itis?
Yeah, I do that a lot.
But is my favorite.
But
sentence.
So you don't just do ums, you do but ums.
I do but ums.
I go like
There you go.
I'll literally say like and then it'll say, but it's like, it's like, see,
it's a filler.
I'm doing it. Okay.
But you know what I'm noticing in today's world, especially with the millennials and then the younger Generation Z that's coming right behind them, they're starting to just be themselves and say the like ums and the ums, and people love you. You got 10 million followers just being you. And so maybe that's what it's about, is just being authentic and being you. And maybe that's what people love, is just that you're being you. And I've just
that's
started.
An important point.
I just started.
Really important point.
And that's what you guys project at the school, is just do you.
Exactly. You know, and, in fact, we have, you know, every year we have some new staff. So we have new people that have joined us. And one of the people at a leadership level in I Lead Schools keeps commenting on how everything is intentional. And it feels, when you go in, kind of casual and laid back, but that's intentional. And so it's fascinating watching people understand that, because I do think it goes along with what you're talking about with millennials and the generations that are coming up. They're more about what are you doing, not making sure all those pieces are perfect. In fact, like, that's why we also have clothing is fairly casual there. That's on purpose, because if we follow the tech industry or entertainment, where they are casual, because we're, see, and I'm saying, I'm talking now, I'm self-conscious okay. about it, but we want people to be authentically themselves. We want people to take away all of that pretense and just look at the meat of what's happening and work together to do something great for society or your project or the school or yourself.
Yeah, I think it's breaking the form that we've been pushed into for so long, and you know, keeping you rigid and it has to look this way, instead of, no, be yourself, express yourself, because the expression is part of the art form and the creativeness that's going to have people notice you and say, I want you for my next film, or I want you for my next production. But why? Because there's something about you. You give yourself permission to just show up and be who you are, and that's what's compelling. That's what pulls people in.
But intentional is a big word there, because I always talk about, and I use clothing just as an example, but when I go to the set with my husband, a lot of people are dressed casually, but it's very intentional the way they have the way they dress, or the way they speak, or the project that they're working on. There's an intention that they're setting out to create it, and that ecosystem and that way of working is on purpose.
I love it. I'm going to ask this question to each one of you. What do you love most about SEVI Charter? What's the feel that you get that's different than some of the other traditional schools that you've been in? How do you contrast the difference between the two schools?
I've been to a lot of schools. SEVI is a very unique school, and I really enjoy that, because when you go to certain places, there are like cliques and like groups of kids, and that's it. They only hang out with that group. But at SEVI, I could be like sitting in the cafe by myself, and a whole group will just kind of like sit there with me. So I find that very interesting, because that's like no other school I've been
to. So there's almost like there's no boundaries of separation. It's just, hey, you're like my cousin, or you're my brother. Like, I already know you just because you come to the school. So you're welcomed and you're approached and you're invited, rather than, no, don't talk to him. So we're not putting each other and separating each other or judging each other.
Yeah, there's
it's
no
just
boundaries.
Warm, and everyone's kind of like this one big family. I love that.
I haven't really had that much experience with public schools, but I feel like at the beginning of SEVI, we weren't that big at the beginning, so we were just considered a family, and I think that now we are still considered a family, because it's just, we all know each other. So, like, in theater, I hang out with, like, I went there, and I didn't really have any of my friends that I usually hang out with in theater, so I actually made new friends, and I still hang out with, like, everyone in my cast.
You know what, Amber, what I'm hearing them say is connection.
Yeah.
I'm hearing about that they're connecting. And when I went to school, and I'm not trying to diss or put anything, when I went to school, I wasn't connecting. I was trying to fit in. But here it seems to be the culture is that we're all connected, and it's an environment where we have permission to connect with each other.
And be yourself.
And be engaged with each other. And in that kind of environment, I can just see, you know, me flapping my wings and having a group of other people that are championing each other on and supporting each other.
And I think that that dynamic comes directly out of, we were very intentional to create that, but also a need in society, because I think a lot of people have in the past, this generation is all about giving back. That's what matters to millennials, making a difference, doing something meaningful. And in past generations, what had mattered was making the most money and getting the most toys. And I don't think this generation cares so much about it. What they care about is connection.
And what about the word leadership? What does leadership mean to you? And are you learning leadership skills that maybe you didn't think that you were going to be learning when you were 6 or 7 years old?
Well, I mean, honestly, when I was 6 or 7 years old, I wasn't really doing anything. But like,
well, yeah, you were just having fun. Yeah, that's what 6 or 7 year olds do.
But this class alone, I feel, has really taught me a lot about leadership.
In what way? Be more specific. What does it mean to be – how are you learning leadership skills? What kind of leadership skills can you tangibly put your fingers on?
Well, as an example, when we were doing the role play thing as mentioned before, we had to kind of take hold of the situation. If the conversation started to die and you were the interviewer, you had to be the one to vamp that thing back up. And I just – I don't know why, but I felt like I took some serious charge of that. I know for a fact, like, I have two friends that participated in that, and when we had to write down, like, an evaluation afterwards of who was, like, the best interviewer, and I know my friends put me that because I was able to take charge and leadership of that conversation.
What I'm hearing you say is that there was a scenario where you were invited to participate in where it forced you to take ownership. You had to own the conversation. You had to drive it. You had to carry it. You had to take it to its completion. And then having that experience – it had you kind of dig down deep and pull some things out that you didn't know you had inside of you.
Yeah,
is that what you're saying?
Exactly.
Okay, and what about you? Leadership skills.
Well, I feel like before this year, I really, whenever I was trying to be a leader, I was not really being a leader. I was kind of taking over. But this year, especially now.
Great comment. That's
a great distinction.
Pretty reflective. Yeah.
And especially this year, I feel like we have already had kind of a group thing. It wasn't a project, but it was like a poster. And I feel like I didn't take over. I was a leader.
I love that, because a lot of people, especially young kids, think that being a leader is projecting your force on and just kind of taking over the project, being a master controller. Mm-hmm. And that's really not what leadership is. Leadership is so multifaceted and so deep that it could be as easy as creating the space and being the invitation and then stepping back and let other people be in charge.
Yeah, that's more management, what you described. And sometimes there's a piece to that that we need, but it's so beautiful that you're willing to look at going beyond that and that you're having those conversations at the school.
I love that. You guys have some things that you want to make, some announcements.
Yeah, we do. On Saturday, September 30th, from 9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m., the Little iLeaders will be offering a free day of play for children and parents. It's called Dress for a Mess. There will be a lot of fun activities like mud puddles, sensory bins, and parachute play. It's also absolutely free, which is a plus. If you want more information on that, you can go to littleleaders.org or you can call 661-383-0400.
Little iLeaders is our newest preschool. We opened a preschool over by SCVI, so we're very excited about that. Early Childhood Education Center.
I did a tour at SCVI, I don't know, about 3 years ago, 4 years ago. I've done a couple of them, and I do them intentionally just to go and get inspired. But I love walking by the preschoolers and the kindergartners because – the way you have it set up in that room, that environment is so amazing. Mm-hmm. The culture that you've developed, to see them with their little mini iPads and it's just inspiring. It's like, okay, well, my grandkids are born. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna plug them in.
It's a fun place to be. Yeah.
But what excited me was the mud puddles.
Yes.
If I went on Saturday and was running around and flopping myself in the mud puddles, would that be okay if I did that? Or because that sounds like fun.
Yeah.
That's what it's for.
Dress for a Mess.
Would you join me if I come and I'm flopping around in the mud puddle? Would you jump in?
Probably. I'm not afraid of that.
I like that. What about you?
Well, Midsummer Night's Dream is in the fall, and it's performed in the Shakespeare Theater, and it is on November 3rd, 4th, and 5th. We don't have the times yet, but it is $15 for adults and $5 for kids.
I love it. Thank you guys so much for being here. I appreciate you. Amber, it's always a pleasure.
Always. Thank you for being here,
Alex.
Yeah,
for sure. Thank you guys. Thank you so much. Thanks for listening on Our Way on the Highway right here in your hometown station, KHTS. Mm-hmm.